When a station carries two programs, one local and one network, the crossing of the two lines can bring unexpected effects. Listen to this.
Loveline. It's time for Loveline.
Who knows? It's going to be sex, drugs, rock and roll.
The crowd seems to love this.
Exclusively on Tucson's new run, 92.1 KFMA, Green Valley, Tucson. K292CM, Summerhaven.
Loveline is meant for an adult audience. Loveline may contain sexually oriented content.
Listener discretion advised.
Now, here's Loveline.
1-800-LOVE-191.
With Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla.
What? Are you insane?
You're inspired by life.
What's that?
You're inspired by life. You're into all this stuff and you're kind of high.
That's what it is, although it never worked that way before. Hey there, it's the Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Dr. Drew is a board-certified physician and addiction medicine specialist. I have no idea what that was.
I'm holding my breath. I'm afraid he's going to drop in that golden one, as you put it.
Phone number for Loveline, 1-800-LOVE-191.
I'm a prostitute. I'm a stripper. Yeah. I've had 5 billion relationships. I don't know whether I'm gay or straight.
Okay, Drew, the mic's hot. Show started, brother.
You be happy now? Now, does that give you a zest for life right there, just hearing that crap? Hey, I'm doing drugs.
Bob Guccione Jr., who's the publisher of Spin and now Gear Magazine, allegedly is coming in here tonight, although we have not seen him yet.
I hear a lot of action out there.
Oh, well, maybe Bob has rolled into the building. We'll learn more about that in just a few minutes. Gear's a new magazine. It's got Daryl Hannah on one page and Animals Humping on another. Oh, is Bob here? You want to just bring him in? Sure. Okay. Bob is here. Keeping with Loveline tradition, our guest, the show starts at 10. Our guests show up at 10.
10:05. 10 to 10:05.
Oh.
You don't be the first one at the party.
That's true. Yeah, it is. That's what it is. Yeah. It's like a party. Yeah, I like that. Hello, Bob. Hey, how are you?
Man, how you doing?
Bob, hey, Drew. How are you?
Nice, nice to meet you. I don't know if we've met before.
On the phone.
Been on the phone
yes,
with you
on
guys,
the phone.
Yeah.
Was that with Adam?
Was I here?
Or was it Ricky then? Ricky and Bob.
Bob is now sitting down and dutifully putting his headphones on. Well, he's still standing up.
It's a very dramatic moment.
He's disrobing. Gear is it's a brand new magazine, right?
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Well, is this the premier issue?
The fourth issue.
Oh, the fourth issue.
Yeah.
And I don't read, so I don't keep up.
I can hold up the pictures for you.
But he does look at the pictures.
I do look at the pictures, yeah. And I like shiny stuff.
This is shiny.
Oh, there's plenty of that in this magazine. Yeah. And there's animals humping.
Yeah, animals humping is a big subject for us.
Yeah, now I notice the slant on this animal humping article is, it says, well, gay pride, and it has a couple of lions on top of each other. There's a lot of...
You seem to have caught the gist of it.
Yes. It's a lot of homosexuality in the animal kingdom.
Yeah, well, the point of the article is that this anthropologist spent 10 years studying animal sexuality and discovered that the animal kingdom is rife with sexual diversity. Homosexuality is a common form, not all an aberration. Threesomes are big. Monogamy doesn't exist.
Right. But they also eat a lot of feces. Is that...
Well,
that's something we should try to weave into our daily life.
I think it's something we probably should spend more time avoiding.
Oh, I see.
I'm
okay.
Not sure we're not guilty of that ourselves sometimes.
But, well, the French, perhaps.
I mean, perhaps the French, for them, it's an improvement.
But
oh, look, here's our friend.
I mean, it's young Petra. Nikita there.
She was the first cover of Gear.
Oh, really?
She was on the premier show. Now, the article we just talked about, the gay pride, the animal thing, this anthropologist, in studying the animal kingdom, discovered that animals are completely diverse and guilt-free with sex. They have threesomes. They have, oral sex. We have a little photograph in there of flies having oral sex.
Yeah,
which
the flies
is
are really
I'm proud
on.
Of.
Yeah, how drunk did you have to get the flies to do this, or did you have to pay their agents, or how does this work?
The photographer pretty drunk to sit there and wait for it to happen. But,
no kidding.
But the point of the article is that after decades, if not centuries, of the Puritan mentality in this country being that if you're having sex for just recreation, it was sinful, and pointing to the animal kingdom as the model of sex for procreation.
Right.
In actual fact, it's not true. The animals also have sex for joy, and when you think about it, sexual energy is just abundant.
Right.
And there's nothing wrong with it, and we've constructed this whole guilt.
Hold on a second,
structure.
Drew. Could you stop leafing through that so
it's
loudly?
A great magazine.
For Christ's sake,
relax. Yeah.
Oh,
just
please.
Listen.
Drew does read. Drew does read.
Well,
read quickly.
Bob, do you think that there's a creator that instilled this in everybody,
yes.
Or is it just nature and the reproduction?
Well, I think it's both. I do believe in a God, and I believe that this is the life force. I think sex is life force. I think joy is a God gift.
Right.
And joy is a life force. I think it's the most potent of all forces.
But
and so therefore it threatens any attempt to control behavior.
Well, they have flies here, and there's a threesome, there's oral sex, there's male masturbating, a personal favorite. There's straight sex.
Are you in this magazine?
I could be chronicled on another page. I God knows, I hope there's no camera in my bathroom. And then there's masturbation, but how, is that the fly's penis? Sticking out there on the masturbation?
I'm afraid it is, yeah.
Why do all animals have bigger dicks than humans? I mean, obviously not...
I would not admit or cop to a fly having a bigger dick than me.
Well, I know, but it's one...
Even if it was true.
Relatively speaking.
It takes up his
relatively
entire...
Relatively speaking, I have to give it in. I have to give it up, I'm sure, yeah.
Yeah, because for your penis to hang with the fly's penis, your penis would have to go from the ground halfway up your chest.
Yeah, right, yeah.
And
it rarely does that.
No, I mean, it might go up the chest, but that's only when you're lying on your back. I mean, it doesn't... How come all animals have bigger penises than humans? Don't you think we got screwed on this whole penis thing?
Well, I had not thought of it until now, but now I do feel...
Well, Adam, think about it.
It works out just fine damaged. The way it is, I promise.
Yeah, but...
I promise.
But can you name me another animal with a smaller proportionate penis than humans? I mean...
Elephants.
Elephants are small?
Proportionally,
yeah. I mean, the size of buildings... Westwood One is not as big as an elephant.
Right. Okay, so you're saying the elephant penis, although it may be 16, 18 inches long, the thing weighs several tons, and if you did the math, at 200 pounds, we'd come out a winner.
I think you find we're most consistent with other primates.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think you find we're adequately equipped.
Yeah, so it works just fine.
The point that Bob...
Yeah, by
the
way, only
male humans worry about this ass. Right.
The point that Bob is making is... That, well, Bob's launched a whole publishing career just based on men's obsession with the penis. But basically.
I like to think it's loftier than that, but it probably isn't.
Well, I don't mean to distill it down.
No. I think you probably hit it pretty much on the head.
God bless the penis. The guys who read these magazines are virile, horny guys, sort of looking
like
for an excuse
you and
to
I.
cheat. Right. And if the animals can cheat, then why can't we?
Well, that's sort of the subtext, I guess, yeah.
Right. If they're having threesomes, if they're having orgies, if they're not being monogamous, who are we to be monogamous and not have orgies? That's slapping our maker in the face, isn't it?
You slap him. I'll stand behind you.
Drew, what do you think of that?
It's a human male dream. I think that's the way men would like things to be. I think for women, it doesn't fit their experience.
I think we're more complex. I think when we're in love, we want to be monogamous, too. I think that's true. But, I think the point of that article is that the guilt trip laid on us for centuries, certainly
right.
for our adult lives, is wrong. It's just
you know
wrong.
What though? We're talking an awful lot of young people, and young people today don't know a world without AIDS, mm-hmm. don't know a world where condoms not supposed to be a part of every sexual act. Don't know a world of repression, really, the way we did.
We didn't in my age too. We had a world of repression too.
No, they don't. They don't know repression. They don't know it. It's they live. They grew up in an entirely different environment than any
no,
of
I
us.
I think it's very
moment.
Repressive. I think the notion of condoms being mandatory is repressive.
Yes.
When I was first becoming sexually active, condoms were thought of as an option, and they were smart, and you know we were dumb if we didn't use them. And I was dumb, but. We didn't have this fear of rampant sexual diseases. Condoms were thought as a way of being smart about getting people pregnant.
No, you're right.
Not going to spend your life with
there's actually a backlash now. Young people are not using condoms because that's something that their parents did, that you're supposed to do, so you're just not doing it. It's like 80% of them don't do it.
80% of
they don't believe statistic. We had an AIDS column at Spin for many years, and at one point, at the height of the AIDS epidemic, there was a statistic that for all of the public awareness about transmission of HIV, the condom sales went up 1%.
Huh. Oh, really?
And that was massive.
Well, look at anything. I mean, look at anything from red meat to cigarettes. And people are alcohol. People are aware that it does some damage, and they're still selling
Everything in moderation, including moderation, as Oscar Wilde
AIDS in moderation? I mean,
AIDS is different.
Really, the classic story is marijuana. If it doesn't if young people don't perceive it as consistent with their perception of reality, they rebel against it.
Mm-hmm.
If marijuana is not going to hurt me, then why the hell can't I use it? And if I'm not probably going to get an STD, why do you tell me I have to wear a condom every time?
Right.
And so they
Well,
they
there's
rebel.
A whole gay subculture right now called barebacking. Have you heard of this?
Mm-mm.
where HIV-positive people are hooking up with HIV-negative people and having unprotected sex with the Russian roulette thrill of transmission.
Oh, Jesus.
And it's a backlash. Oh, it's incredible. It's frightening. We're doing an article on the next issue on barebacking. And,
really?
No, it's a subculture. It's very big in New York. It's big all across the country, but it's particularly big in New York. And it's a backlash against this notion that you had to have safe sex and, you know, transmission was imminent, and people were finding they weren't getting it, and people were finding that HIV wasn't inexorably causing AIDS. And it's a weird thing. It's a kind of, it's obviously a self-destructive thing.
Is it in the gay community?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. So,
But they have barebacking parties.
You have gay. Imagine mopping up after one of those barebacking parties. Just emptying the ashtrays would be would be trouble. But you have a gay men who don't have HIV. Partnering up.
Having unprotected sex with HIV positive guys, and that's the thrill.
Oof. Oh, they got to be. Their parents got to be pissed. Oh. I got to tell you. Yeah, but I would argue that whoever's getting barebacked upon is just nuts. Just flat nuts. I mean, you got to be. And the people who are positive for having sex with these unprotected sex with people who aren't infected are fairly despicable, too, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, that's what I wonder, what the legal aspects of all that is.
Really?
You know what I mean? Whether or not somebody's liable for their behavior. Yeah.
I mean, so what the legal aspects are, I don't know.
Well,
that's the sort of thing, you know, you talk about backlash. And, you know, let's talk about another thing. Totally politically incorrect. There is no heterosexual AIDS epidemic. There never has been. There never will be. That is a fact.
In this country?
Yes, in this country. Well, now, when you talk about Africa and you talk about Asia, you're talking about such unreliable data that it's hard to say. I'm not saying it's not true. I'm just saying that you have to recognize the factor of unreliable data, such as in Africa, HIV tests are so expensive proportionally to the African income that most people never have them. Hospitals don't administer them. And also, in a country where malaria, in the world, malaria is the number one killer. And in Africa, it is the number one killer by many, many times over. And the World Health Organization, the last time statistics were reported, put $57,000 into Africa for malaria. And they put, in Uganda, and they put $2 million in for AIDS. So
right.
What does the doctor and the hospital say when they are reporting the death? They say, they're AIDS deaths.
Right, so you can keep the money coming. So
yeah, because
Liz Taylor will drop off more money next week.
Exactly. That's exactly it. You know,
sure,
what you just said so flippantly is so damn true.
I know. Listen, we've talked about it on the air 100 times, and I know it's not a real popular position, but people in this country don't want to see the difference in everything. If there's AIDS, then everyone's got AIDS.
Yeah.
We all have the exact same chance of getting it. We should all wear condoms, and we should all cower and have monogamous relationships. And it's not true. There's certain lifestyles, gay, IV, drug users, whatever, that puts you in a higher risk.
You know, let's quantify it, because I'm going to get in a soapbox a little bit here. Forgive me, because we had an AIDS column at Spin for 10 years, and I published Spin before Gear. And we did this very seriously and very studiously. We discovered that when you look at the common denominator factors among people who actually get AIDS as opposed to HIV, you find out they are entirely promiscuous, either prostitutes or homosexuals, who have multiple lovers every night. Therefore, they're intaking foreign proteins to the factor of 30 a night, 20 a night. Well, if you...
It's like Drew in college.
When we guys were single and younger, and I'm at least younger and single, come think of it. You know, you kiss three girls in a week at three different dates. You got a cold at the end of the week. Imagine having 30 different sets of proteins ingested into your system, as was happening in the gay bathhouses in the height of the 80s. How many different proteins, how many different sexually transmitted diseases are you getting? It overwhelms the immune system. The other high risk factor are drug users. Now, when a person takes coke or heroin, seriously takes it, whether they take it intravenously or not, they don't sleep and they don't eat. Both impact the immune system dramatically.
Right.
And, of course, they also have sex indiscriminately. So they have sex with people who have syphilis and gonorrhea and everything else, because that's the pool of people who are so desperate for each other. So they were overwhelming their immune system. Now, the average monogamous gay fella who caught HIV invariably doesn't come down with AIDS.
Really? Drew, what do you think of that?
Now, let me tell you this, too. The other statistic we found was the prostitutes who... got HIV but weren't drug abusers invariably did not come down with AIDS. Those who were drug abusers invariably did, because the drug abuse itself alone is such a health hazard. It would reduce the immune system and make them prone to anything.
Drew, what do you think?
It goes against my experience a little bit. I mean, one is that somebody who's otherwise responsible who gets an infectious disease may begin taking care of themselves, may take appropriate therapies, and so may be less likely to progress, or certainly progress less slowly. There's something called the, I think it's called the Will Rogers effect. If you look at a disease at a slice in time, you don't get the full spectrum of people across the course of the disease. You get the number that, you know, during that period of time who died, for instance, and people who obviously who got the disease earlier, who weren't taking it, didn't take advantage of nutritional therapies or lifestyle therapies or antiviral therapies, died sooner.
Are you saying Will Rogers had the HIV?
I think that's what they called it, the Will Rogers effect. The other thing, though, is that, and I treat lots of IV drug users, lots and lots and lots, and I'm always amazed that they seem to go on and on and on with the HIV. It's like, these are the ones, I they catch you and think, oh God, this is going to be a disaster because of exactly what you're talking about. And yet my experience has been, boy, they just keep, and they don't, and they do not take care of themselves, and they do not take antiviral therapy, I almost wonder if there's some sort of stimulation of the immune system that allows them to tolerate the contrast intravenous medication.
You just said something very interesting. They don't take antiviral therapy. We discovered in the many articles we did at Spin, that, and we're doing a big AIDS article in our September issue of Gear, because the same writer who did the AIDS column works for me at Gear, Celia Farber, and we're doing one that's going to just upset everybody because it's so politically incorrect. But we discovered that the people who were HIV positive and didn't take AZT or DDI or protease inhibitors lived longer. The people who took AZT invariably died, because AZT, as you know, is so utterly toxic. It was originally shelved as a cancer treatment.
Yeah, but again, you got to look at what period of history of the treatment of this disease you're looking at. I mean, more recently with the cocktails and all, there's a strong correlation between suppressing viral load and surviving longer.
I don't screw up his next article.
Here's the thing that bothers me, though. The people have a confusion between politically incorrect and scientifically incorrect. You know, people should not be afraid to say things that are politically incorrect if they're scientifically correct.
I agree. Let me just tell you about the protease thing just quickly, because it is this article we're doing, and not to, you know, not to belabor the point, but you may know this. There are a lot of studies that when they went longer than the original studies proved that people didn't last on protease inhibitors. And they did a study with mice in which they removed a certain gene that the HIV virus stuck to.
Right.
So these mice did not get the HIV virus. However, they died in 20 days, because when you remove that protein, you actually remove their ability to take nutrition in their food. Yeah. So they died of lack of nutrition. They just died. And that's what the protease inhibitors are doing in humans. They're actually killing the ability of the cells to withdraw nutrition. And no one is surviving on protease inhibitors. And now everybody's backing out of it. It's like the Japanese boardroom when the company's been disgraced and everybody backs away from the tail. It's really interesting watching these scientists. Ho has been completely discredited. And our article is going to expose an awful lot of the knowing fraud, the knowing complicity to proceeding with something they knew wouldn't work.
All right. We're going to take some calls. Drew?
Yep.
You going to pop off about this later, or you all right?
I'm off right now.
Okay. If I get the HIV, I'm moving in with Bob.
The HIV.
Allison.
Yes.
You're 14.
Mm-hmm.
You're on with Bob Guccione Jr.
Hi.
Hi. How you doing?
Pretty good.
Good.
Okay. My, this guy that I'm together with is where you've been kind of getting a little intimate lately, and I'm wanting to know if I'm too young or if I should have sex, because I'm... It's almost like I've been wanting to have it. It's almost like I've been having, this may sound weird, but almost like craving to have it. But it's weird because we've been kind of getting in little arguments lately about just little things, you know?
Well, Bob was telling me off the air that raccoons start having sex at 2 years old. So it just do the math, you know? Right, Drew?
How's the guy?
He's 15.
Yeah.
What do you say,
yeah,
Drew?
But I have, when I was 12, I was going out with a 15-year-old.
Yeah.
And he almost raped me twice, and I went to therapy for that.
Yeah.
And he has, like, we're friends now, which is cool, you know. And
you're friends with the guy who tried to rape you?
Yeah, I know how weird that sounds, but, like, yeah. But
did he try to rape you, or was he just being incredibly aggressive?
He might have been incredibly aggressive, but he locked me in the car, and he wouldn't let me out, and he took me to... this place.
Well, that's beyond incredible.
The fact that you would hang out with people like that make us concerned about your judgment, okay?
Well, she was 12, and he was 15.
I know. And know this, that of all the people we talk to, it is exceedingly rare for us to talk to a 14-year-old or somebody who had sex when they were 14 who was happy. Wait, listen. Who was happy with that decision, who didn't wish they had waited.
Yeah.
Okay, so just hang in there. Just don't be in a big hurry, okay?
Okay. And then also, about the morning after pill.
Yeah.
It's
my favorite.
Drew likes the peppermint.
I'm having one right now.
Would I be able to get it myself without my parents' consent?
You what?
Would I be able to get that myself without my parents' consent?
I believe in most states, if not all states right now.
Hey, yes. Allison, don't start plotting to have unprotected sex, though, at 14.
Yeah, by the way.
Never have unprotected sex.
Yeah, if you're going to, remember that emergency contraception is there for for emergencies. Mm-hmm. That if you want to have contraception, go get the pill and use it the way it's designed to be used.
Chris.
Yes.
You're 21.
I am. Okay, let me see how I can get this explained. Last summer I was working at just basically a computer job, and I befriended an older coworker. She's 31 now. I'm 21. We talk off and on, and one night we got to talking about sex, and she mentioned that her younger sister had been telling her that she should try to have a baby, because apparently she's having a baby now, and she really wants one. We were talking about sex one night, and she said to me, basically, can you help me out, if you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And at first, I thought she was joking. And, I'm attracted to her. I'm very sexually attracted to her.
So you said, let's start with oral sex, and then we'll think about it?
No, I didn't see anything yet. But she said, how about this weekend? And I'm debating whether or not to. And I don't want to have a kid, I know that, but my hormones are kind of speaking to me, right?
Well, why don't you tell her okay and then just pull out at the end and laugh like a hyena?
Back to the animal references, guys. Easy.
While you're going all over the comforter.
What makes the hyenas pull out?
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Hey, Chris?
Yes?
I know you're extra horny.
Yes.
You're 21.
Mm-hmm.
But it just doesn't sound like a great plan.
No, I think you can hold out for a better offer, let me tell you.
Well,
Bob Grigioni is telling you can hold out for
right.
some.
Even I.
Bob has seen this devious.
I was going to consider anything, he's saying this doesn't sound good to him.
This sounds like the entry price is a little bit high.
Yeah, I've always had a fantasy about older women. And,
well, listen.
At your age, man, they're all
Chris,
older.
There's nothing wrong with exploring some sort of relationship with this person. If you go in understanding there's something up with her, I don't know what. But if you want to do that, that's fine. But don't go in under the pretense that you're going to give her a child.
I'm telling you, go over there and go, how about we just get things started with a little oral sex? And then about 5 minutes in, just go, oh!
All right, Sir Walter Raleigh, let's go on, shall we?
Good luck, though.
Well, anyone who tries to coax someone who's 10 years their junior into knocking them up when they're off work deserves everything they get.
Maybe he misread. Maybe it was she with Joe. Who knows? I mean, the point is something's up, right?
All right.
Let's not judge her lest
we be judged?
Yes.
Okay, well, take a little break. When
Let's
we come
definitely
back,
not be judged.
Jerry...
I refuse to be judged.
Jerry's 28. His ball sack is veiny and droopy, and
I thought this
people
was a
notice
thought,
it.
I love Balzac. He's one of the best French novelists.
I thought it was a question about Balzac, too.
I tell you.
All right. We
French
will,
literature, my favorite.
We'll be back with the well-read Bob Guccione Jr. and more Balzac discussion after this.
Loveline's phone number is 1-800-LOVE-191.
Loveline!
With Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew. We'll be right back.
Loveline. Bob Guccione Jr. is here. Here's the name of the new magazine he has out. Of course, you know his work from Spin. How many years has Spin been around?
About 212.
Wow. Before the press.
Yeah, before the press. I guess it's 14 as of last March.
Really?
Yeah, this past March.
Doesn't Spin feel like a new magazine
Gutenberg
to you?
Was the original publisher.
Okay.
Yeah, I was
Steve.
I was with it for 12 years. I started and sold it just under 2 years ago. It's amazing how long ago that is already.
Did you make a ton of money?
I did, actually, yeah. That's but mostly, I was just... I mean, the money was there, and it would have been there a year later. It was there a year earlier. Frankly, I just felt I'd done it. There was nothing left for me to do. I was no longer... as in touch with the culture as I would like to have been as a good editor. I wasn't editing it daily. I wasn't getting much of a kick out of it personally. The magazine was strong and is very strong today. It didn't need me.
Well,
I felt personally like I was just useless.
For a guy with the entrepreneurial spirit that I guess you have, isn't the sort of challenge and excitement or adrenaline pump from starting new projects, getting them going, and then once they're sort of on their feet and going and successful, you look on to the next challenge?
Absolutely right.
I would never do that. My whole thing is I get something going and then nap.
No one would mistake you for someone who would. Don't worry.
But you know, my whole
napping
plan...
Napping is good, by the way, Adam. You're not on the wrong track, man.
If you just limit it to napping.
All right, well, I got a masturbator. I can't fall asleep. That's what you're asking, Drew. My whole plan
is... I think that was...
Well, I know what he was implying. My whole thing is I want to start something and then sell it. You know what I mean?
I want to start something and then masturbate.
And then sell it.
And then sell it, yeah.
Well, you know what I mean? Isn't there something really cool about whether
building
it's a...
something, yeah.
Whether it's a... Even if it's an idea...
It's great building something.
You start it, you have it, you turn it into its own entity, and then you sell it to some foreigners for way too much money.
Adam is no fool.
Who'd you sell this to? Foreigners?
From California, same thing.
Oh, yeah. Well, everyone's from somewhere. Jerry...
Yes.
You're 28. You have a ball sack related question?
That's me. Anyways, Adam, Drew,
yeah.
Bob, pleasure.
Thanks.
Anyways, the problem I believe to be a true problem is the discomfort I have from, well, my sack hanging low and perhaps a little bit of mass also. The discomfort I suffer, of course, is just from sitting and always having to pull up. And I don't know. I have good insurance, but I'm kind of reluctant to go in if there's...
Well, do you have an unusually large sack?
I believe, yes. I've had people notice, as a matter of fact. And it's kind of embarrassing. And even my wife, if my seam goes the wrong way, it all bundles up on one side. And, you know, my wife makes me straighten it out and everything. But... the issue is just, I mean, it's just totally uncomfortable, and I think it's
uncomfortable because you're sitting on it?
Yes, I can't sit on them.
I understand what we're being asked here, though.
Do they go in your ass if you sit on them?
Well, not quite that far back.
Okay.
But
well, I just
right underneath my leg. And
what are you asking of us, Jerry?
Perhaps about anything like, I remember before them saying the veins have dropped, and the doctor said if I ever have problems with fertility, they could do something about removing those.
That's a varicocele. Yeah, those are little...
Is that any kind of medical threat to have a big...
No, not that I can think of.
I have two children.
You're fine.
And so that's fine. Can I still go in and have something done?
Like a vasectomy? What are you asking? I don't
understand. Yeah, what do you want done?
He wants to tuck them up.
Man, I'd be proud of it. I mean...
Yeah. You want to tuck?
I need to get rid of the mass.
The mass?
Why?
The discomfort.
Whoa. It's the first time I heard you mention a mass. You have a mass inside the testy?
Yeah, I have a... there's a lot of stuff in there.
All right.
Wait a minute. I'm still not sure. Let me talk to Jerry in private for a second.
Mano y mano, huh?
Jerry, step into the bathroom.
All right, I'm there.
Okay, now, do you have unusually large balls, or do you have more than one mass or more than two masses inside of your ball sack?
I have probably average-sized balls with a lot of veiny material, and
right.
The sack hangs low.
I have a hanging sack.
There's no cyst or anything.
He has true varicosities. It's not a varicocele. He has, like, you see, what it feels like with guys have is kind of things like a bag of worms in there, right?
Yes.
Yeah, and it's actually varicose veins, lots of them in there. And, yeah, I'm not aware of what procedure they would do, but I bet they could do something for that. So, yeah, go get something done.
Don't they have one of those orthopedic socks you wear
You need to see a urologist. Yeah, Job's stocking. Yes, you
right.
Job's stocking.
Well, they wouldn't laugh at me and tell me to leave.
No. You go ahead and get
that done.
Urologists
don't laugh.
No, it's not a funny business. Yeah.
I'm kind of self-conscious about
it. No, Jerry, come on.
All right,
how did I know? Without seeing you, I knew exactly what you had, right?
Yeah, it's not an uncommon
thing.
Laughing.
And no. I'm not laughing.
It feels like a sack of worms in there?
Well, not when I sit on them.
Yeah, it's a bunch of someone kicked me
in the couleons.
Okay, yeah. Are you wearing underpants?
Well, yes, I have to wear those briefs to hold them up.
Good. That's what you should do.
You do what I do. You duct tape the whole mess to your belly before you leave the house. That's what I do. I'll take the whole thing. I call it the turtle. I'll take the whole thing. I'll just put the whole thing against my abdomen. I'll just put a thing of duct tape across.
Why just go the other way?
There. In between the legs?
Yeah, back, up.
Yeah, it's hard to walk. Besides, and if you get raped, they think you're a chick, and then the trouble really starts. They see the turtle, they run. Mary.
Yeah, that would be me.
You're 27.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Sorry, I'm kind of ill. Uh-huh. I'm calling about narcissism and whether or not y'all think that actually exists or not.
Oh, I have no doubt it exists.
We have no doubt.
Okay.
We have all experienced.
Yeah, all right. Sure. I know that Bob Guccione Jr. probably has some idea of being as you're around rock stars and all that. My mom was just diagnosed with it by a huge treatment center that she went into.
Did they tell you that puts you at risk too?
Kind of.
Yeah.
She went in for all sorts of stuff for bulimia and alcoholism and everything. I'm all like, I've been trying to grapple with which situation I'm in, which player, you know, at what stage, hero, whatever the other ones are, radical person.
What's your question?
Narcissism,
you know, people mistake narcissism. People mistake narcissism for vanity. We're not talking about people that are just vain or into themselves. We're talking about people that have difficulty acknowledging the existence of other people, basically.
But that's what's happened. And that's
all right, hold on. Shut up, Mary.
It's largely built on a lot of shame and emptiness, and people get through life with this disorder by sort of propping themselves up, doing things that makes themselves feel good about themselves, but it's that bottomless pit you and I talk about.
Like traveling in first class with a dog.
Yeah, and
that kind of activity.
But no, it's more the people around them. They need to be very, very successful in doing things, and people around them sort of propping them up, making them feel okay about themselves, because underneath it is a lot of emptiness and shame.
So it's like your posse or your lackeys.
Well, it's like people at
junior editors in Bob's case. I mean, that sort
of
thing.
Kind
of thing.
Full staff.
But Mary, what, go ahead,
staff,
I'm sorry.
And their families.
Mary?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Good. Well, what you say sounds so close to home.
Yeah.
And
there's a difference between narcissistic traits and narcissistic personality disorder. And I'm an internist. I'm not a psychiatrist. And I'm not sure I understand fully how people in mental health make the difference. But certainly having had a narcissistic mother would almost guarantee narcissistic traits in you. And those things are very, in a highly motivated person, can be very approachable through therapy.
But I find that my relationships are getting worse.
Yeah.
My romantic relationships, and now it's gotten to the point where I'm not even talking to the people that I'm romantically interested in. We have these relationships that go on that, you know, sometimes we talk, but it's to keep the person at such a distance. And then when you talk, it's like you are not actually having a dialogue, and I'm not even communicating with the person. You just sort of talk about yourself, and somehow the other person's supposed to extrapolate from that.
Yeah, and people with narcissism go through these cycles of overvaluing and then devaluing themselves and others.
Yeah.
And they need to keep themselves.
How do you correct it? How can a person correct it?
It's about... It's basically, the way I conceptualize, and there's lots of different theories about this, but the easiest way I know to conceptualize it is a disruption of the normal attachment process. When we develop as infants, we need a very close shared system with the mother. Mm-hmm. And if that ruptures in some way, then the brain has to develop other sorts of ways of managing that lack of connection. So one of the ways to heal is to regain that connection. It takes a lot of time and a lot of effort, a lot of motivation, and a lot of talent on the part of the therapist, because he has to be able to maneuver through some very delicate and treacherous defenses.
Well, as you know, I'm not a narcissist, Drew, but I'm tired of talking about Mary, and I'd like to sing. So, if so that'd be all right.
A couple great, but one is The Culture of Narcissism by a guy named Christopher Lash, which predicted the predominance of that personality style in our culture today, and he was absolutely right. I wrote that book in the early 70s.
Trish.
Hello?
You're 19.
Yeah.
He also predicted we'd be driving hovercrafts by now, though, didn't he?
No, he didn't. No.
Okay. I'd like to kick all those guys in the nuts. By the year 2000, we'll colonize space. We'll be traveling to the moon for a weekend.
They meant Spain.
Living underwater.
We'll in fact colonize Spain by the year 2000.
Trish.
Yeah.
All right. So you're 19. What's going on?
Well,
I've been seeing this guy for, I guess, about 3 months, and everything's been going okay between us and everything, but in the process of being around him for these 3 months, I've gotten to be pretty good friends with his brother.
Mm-hmm.
And his brother is the exact opposite from him. The guy I'm with right now, he's great to be around and all, and he's real fun and everything, but he's off in his own place. He's not...
Right, so you're into his brother.
I'm not sure if I am or not.
Yeah, I'm telling you,
we kind of all guess this.
Yeah, so if you haven't done anything with his brother yet.
No, but we just had a conversation tonight that...
What kind of conversation?
Well, I called to talk to his brother originally because he had just gotten back from Virginia, but he wasn't there, so I ended up talking to his brother.
Here's the beauty of our show. What kind of conversation?
Well, I'm supposed to go over there on Thursday, and I have a feeling that something's going to happen between us.
You're
going to
go over there Thursday, and you know the guy you're dating's not going to be there.
Yeah.
Okay. Hold on a second. We got to take a break. All right, Trish?
Okay.
Can you not have sex with him for about 4 minutes?
I'll try.
Okay, do that. Bob Guccione Jr. is here. Drew's decided it's time for him to call the hospital. So he's picked up and left. And we'll come back and get to the bottom of Trish after this.
Loveline is coming back.
Call 1-800-LOVE-191. Operators are standing by.
Loveline will be back in a minute.
Hey, we started the show. Bob Guccione Jr. is here. It's Loveline. Gear's the name of his new magazine. It's been out for this is its fourth issue.
It's been out 6 months, nearly 8 months.
Daryl Hannah is on the cover. Now,
she asked to be on the cover. She called us up.
Oh, really?
Yeah, she saw
that's
the pictures.
Cool.
She saw the pictures of Peter Wilson in the first issue. They were taken by a photographer who she was friendly with. So she said, hey, I can do that. I can blow Peter away. And I thought that was the kind of challenge I would definitely respond to.
So we
said, great, put her on the cover. And she's a fascinating woman.
I'm amazed. To me, Daryl Hannah has been around for now 15 years.
How old is she now? Yeah.
She looks exactly the same as she did.
She's 38 and she's incredibly beautiful.
I know. There's just nothing like a good genetic hand. You know, you're 6 foot, you're built like a teenage boy, and you just look fantastic. You got high cheekbones, a big fat lips, and a lot of blonde hair. I mean, she was in...
She had a beautiful body, too.
Oh, yeah, look at this.
Say she's too skinny, but she's really not.
No, too skinny, it's all right when you get older. You start packing a little meat on, and then it all works out. She was in, what's that Tom Hanks movie I was thinking of?
Splash.
If she's in Splash, that movie's like from the 40s. She still looks
that was
amazing.
Last week.
Okay. Well, it's been like 14, 15 years
since
Splash.
I know, it's amazing.
Bridget?
Yes.
What
happened to Trish? We lost Trish.
Hold on just a minute.
What was I going to talk to?
No, finish with Trish.
Oh, that's right. True, whenever you draw it this way, it always confuses me. I know, but you should put an arrow through.
Trish, you back?
I'm here.
Trish, you're 19.
Mm-hmm. You're going to screw your boyfriend's brother. Let's get to the bottom of this, right?
Right.
Are you sexually attracted to the boyfriend's brother and not the boyfriend?
I don't know if I want to do that, though. I'm confused as to what I should do.
Trish, I can hear it in your voice. You like chaos.
Oh, yeah.
You like to stir things up. If you were going out with the brother you want to screw, currently, you'd be wanting to screw the guy you're screwing now.
That's right.
Because you got that chaos in your voice, right?
I don't think so. I don't think I'd do that.
Let's talk about other relationships you've had.
Okay.
Have you had any?
Yeah.
What happened with those?
They've been kind of strange.
Why is that? What happened?
I haven't had regular relationships, really.
Why is that?
You guys are going to get the complete wrong impression of me.
No, I think we're going to get the complete right one.
You're right, yeah. Don't underestimate us.
We're
men of the world.
What is up with the old relationships?
Because I've split other people up.
Sure.
Oh, let me see. The word chaos comes to mind.
Yeah, why would Adam think about chaos in a relationship? Hmm.
Damn good guess.
Jeez. And I'm
floored. You split other people up, huh?
Hmm?
You split people up?
By the way, we're shocked.
And what happened after you split the people up?
They last for about 6 months, and then...
Right.
And they kill themselves?
No, she cheats.
You cheat, right?
I don't cheat. I've never cheated on anybody before.
Well, how do you split people up?
It hasn't been me that's been cheating. I've been helping other people in it.
No, no, but how does your relationship with the cheaters end?
I just get tired of it, and I move on to the next person.
All right, so you're into sort of chaos, meaning you don't really know you're alive in a relationship unless there's a little danger, a little drama.
Yeah, I hate it when things get too settled down.
Yeah, because when things get settled down, you have to have feelings, and that's what this is about avoiding, about having any real intimacy or real relationships with people. So instead, you have all these chases and chaos and craziness.
I hear you guys talk about people's childhoods, and I've had a wonderful childhood. I mean, nothing bad has happened to me in my life to make me avoid emotional involvement.
Well, it doesn't mean that there was wholesale abuse because a 19-year-old girl wants a little challenge and a little chaos in a relationship. But it usually means, I don't know, dad worked a little too much and wasn't home enough, or maybe dad split the scene at some point, and maybe Drew's coughed up a lung there.
This is another one of those narcissistic mom situations.
Oh, you think so?
Yeah.
What happened, Trish?
No, nothing happened. She wouldn't perceive it.
She wouldn't.
Mom is just that way.
Your parents still...
Don't you think that sometimes I found in my experience with... young women who've worked for me and young women I knew years ago, that there's a point when they become aware of their sexual power.
Oh, yeah.
And it's like becoming aware of having a nuclear reactor in your basement.
In your pants.
In your pants.
Bob calls the crotch basement.
Yeah,
right.
Really, you know, I was using an old-fashioned English term.
Right. Mind if I check your basement, Governor? Seems there's a leak in your basement.
Oh, my God, it's a nuclear leak. But I think with women... discovered as that moment in their late teens and early 20s, when they discover they have sexual power, that it becomes unleashed.
Yeah.
And not necessarily all for good.
There's a book out there called Promiscuities that talks about how little our society does to help women manage that and the sort of mixed messages they get.
Because we're scared.
Men are scared to death with
totally.
Sexuality.
Absolutely.
I mean, you look at.
We are frightened to death.
I think it's fascinating that some of the great, the template Poseidon, the great Greek temple, the whole. Fresco or the frieze is about Apollo overcoming the Amazons.
Mm-hmm.
That's the whole religious context of why Apollo's a great god.
Because nothing reduces us more than a woman's sexual power if we care about him.
Hey, Drew?
Yeah.
Try to make references that are a little more current. We have a young stoned audience. Try to talk about JJ's
yeah, I got it. I
Walker's
that.
Work and Good Times or something
okay.
like that. Try
to
go back
that.
Quite that far. Hey, Trish, are you good looking?
I'm pretty attractive.
All right. Well, where's your dad?
He's with my mom.
And they're together, and he paid plenty of attention to you when you were little.
When I was younger, we got along a lot better than, like, around the time I hit, like, 14 or 15.
Yeah.
And when I turned, like, around 14 or 15, he just started backing off, and we got into fights a lot until I moved out.
All right. Well, anyway, Trish, here's the deal. You can run your cycle with this, but it's kind of endless, and it's kind of empty.
Empty.
What can I do to stop myself?
Well, just don't do it. Don't act out on it.
You don't have to follow these dysfunctional impulses. Yeah. Please, go. What? Hey, everybody. You don't have to act
out. You want
out.
Me to yell at everybody?
Yes, please.
Hey, everybody. What should I say?
Don't act out.
Oh, don't act out. Well,
you don't have
listen,
to act
here's
out.
What we're saying. Everybody, it's like if you have an impulse, then you do it. If you want to kill someone, you kill them. If you want to F somebody, you F them. If you want to break up a relationship, you break up a relationship. Everyone is so busy chasing their muse, and their muse begins in their underpants, that they just go. I mean, talk about narcissism. Listen, everybody, here's what separates us from the animals. I hate to get back to Bob's issue of gear with lions. Humping lions, but this is what separates us. We have the ability to stop ourselves and not act on autopilot. That's what stops...
By the way, it's incredibly liberating when you get to that point in life when you don't just act on impulses, because you find most impulses come from fear. They come from fear of inadequacy. They come from fear of low self-worth,
being alone, being empty, that kind of thing.
And right.
See, Adam and I, just, we've lost the will to live, and that's why we sort of stopped.
That's why I stopped acting out. I don't have any soul anymore.
This is becoming like self-confession of three guys in here. Soon we won't need the callers.
Well, it is
true. We'll just all confess to each other.
Bob, I don't know how old you are, but certainly you're out of your 20s.
Think
about the energy you had in your early 20s for screwing, for fighting, for chaos, for just general mischief.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying?
Totally correct.
I mean, the difference is that if you walked into a liquor store when you're 21 and the guy yelled at you and threw you out, you'd be back in an hour with a few of your buddies and a bat or whatever. Now you just go home, you masturbate, go to sleep, and you cry.
That's not exactly the entirety of my life, no.
You don't do that now?
Not in that order.
Not in that order.
But the point is you don't have that same sort of energy for mischief and chaos.
Thank God, because it was appropriate at that time. And it teaches you a lot. You learn a lot, but hopefully you do learn, you do evolve. And
Brigitte.
Bridget?
Yes.
You're 29.
Hi. I think you guys are great. I'll be right back, okay? I think you guys are great, and I think you do a lot of good. And I have been dying to get in for so long, and I finally got in. I want to join your political party, Adam, when you come into power, because... I think there's way too many people in this world having kids that shouldn't be.
Well, it's not really going to be a party. It's just going to be a monarchy.
A movement.
Well,
I'm just going to rule.
Agree with you for the simple fact that I was born in a chaotic childhood. I had a chaotic childhood, and I am like living proof of it messes with you for the rest of your life. And so, you know, I am right on with you.
But how about being living proof that you can overcome it and get better and grow?
Yeah, and I am living proof of that also.
Yeah.
However, I'm still plagued by what has happened to me in certain areas of my life, like picking, bad relationships and things.
Do you have kids?
No, I don't.
You're brilliant.
I have not found anyone worthy enough to have kids with, so I am truly one of the smart ones who has, made good out of what's happened to me.
Yes.
Do you want kids?
I do want kids, yeah, but I thank God that, I don't know if you believe in a God or whatever, but
sure I do.
Somebody has been with me to have put a good head on my shoulders. I have been physically, sexually, and emotionally abused by three different men in my life, and I was always had a good head on my shoulders. I put myself through college.
Bridget, hold it right there. We got to go to break.
Okay.
I want to talk a lot more to you.
Okay.
So
we do?
I want to talk to her.
I think that's enough. She's got a good head on her shoulder. She's not pregnant.
She hasn't asked her question yet. She just inspired us. So come on.
She has a question? What is your question?
No, after the break. All right?
You have a question?
Oh, don't say it. Don't say it.
Truce, don't argue with me. I'm running this goddamn show. Do you hear me? I'll have Bob. Bob will have you killed.
When you're the monarch.
I'll have Bob have you killed. Do you understand that?
Yeah. Heather, kill him.
Yeah, Guccione. Do you know what that means? That means to kill in Italian. Do you understand that?
To have killed.
Kill without conscience.
That's right. Okay.
Italian.
Bob Guccione Jr. is here. We'll take a little break. We'll be back.
Adam and Dr. Drew will be right back on Loveline. Just a minute or two. Call 1-800-LOVE-191.
Love Line, 92.1 KFMA. It is Love Line. We got to take a quick, 10-second station identification, and we'll be back with more Love Line in just 10 seconds.
This is Love Line on
radio
station. The new rock. Trending. 92.1 KFMA. Great Valley, Tucson.
She drinks until she barely has her senses about her, and then she can relax enough to have sex with me.
Drew, the mic's
right. Where'd that come from?
Bob Guccione Jr. is our guest tonight. Gear is the name of his latest endeavor. It's a new magazine. It's been out for about four issues.
That's very cool.
Daryl Hannah is on the cover, or as Bob would pronounce it, Daryl Hanner, is on the cover of this month's Gear, and she's looking better than ever. And guess what, everybody? She's not wearing a coffee sack. She's in a pair of nice briefs and has like a surf shirt on top, but it's sort of see-through.
She walked into my office,
She did.
3 weeks ago. I was just doing work. This is how boring my life is. I was actually didn't notice Daryl Hannah walked into my office. I looked up and there's this gorgeous blonde and I said, oh, hello, how do you say? I'm Daryl. I'm Bob. We chatted for a few seconds. And she looked at the photographs that were going into the magazine. And she says, there's a lot of pictures of my nipples. And I went putting on my best, wow, I'm shocked to see we picked those pictures. Said,
ow!
Yes, exactly.
He just got done with his more nipple memo that had been circulated through there. And he
asked, there's a leak. There's a leak, a security leak. They know too much.
You know, what did she expect? I mean,
well,
she's
no, she actually called up a photographer and said she wanted to do that kind of stuff. And let me tell you, it's really classy. She's a very sexy woman, and it comes through.
No kidding. And like I said, I don't know. She's well into her 30s now, right? I mean,
yeah, she's 38.
38.
And the piece is very good. The writer, an LA-based writer who's one of our staff writers, Chrissy Eiley. And, you know, Daryl Hannah very rarely gives an interview at all.
Yeah, you don't see her do much.
And she gave a really good, insightful piece to us. I'm proud of the piece. I'm proud of the way the magazine's coming because I always say I never apologize for being sexy and I don't apologize for being intellectual. It's both.
Is it easier to sell advertising when you're coming off of Spin and your name is involved with it and it's not an upstart thing where you haven't explained to them what it is?
It is, actually, thank God. I probably wouldn't have started it without having that wind at my back. Spin was such a success, and of course that wasn't always true. It was a tough road for 10 of the first 12 years, but it wound up being a big success, and people who had invested in me then, who put ads in the magazine, realized that it did work and that it did have an audience, and so they were just more open to hearing about gear, and it gave us a real great launch. We were the most successful independent launch in 1998.
Wow.
Of all magazines. 900 magazines came out. The only magazines, I think, were three magazines that actually had more ad pages and more circulation than us. All came from big conglomerates.
How much do you fetch for a page? Not necessarily in gear, but like, let's say you wanted to take out a full-page ad. And I know it must vary from issue to issue. If it was Sports Illustrated, sure. I'm guessing it would be more during the swimsuit issue.
$150,000 for Sports Illustrated.
But, wow. Is that for the swimsuit, or is that just in general?
Look quick. that's for them in general. There's more for the swimsuit issue.
And what is the most expensive? I mean, what's Playboy?
No, I think Parade is up there in the several hundred thousands.
Really? And what?
Parade has a circulation of like 33 million.
Parade's the USA Today thing, right?
No, it's bigger than that. The USA Today is copying it. It's perhaps the worst publication ever presented. It is anemic. In every facet, the paper, the ink, the stories, the writing, the subjects are totally anemic. But it has to be because it's diluted across 33 million newspaper insertions. It's a free insertion in newspapers. And the big story this week was Ving, whatever his name is, the actor with his dog. I mean, this is the low level of it. But for that, to be in that audience, you get to pay $500,000 for a page or something.
Well,
but the average for like a magazine like mine, well, we're very small now because we're small circulation, we're 200,000. So we're charging, you know, about $16,000.
What did Spin start off as?
About $4.10. And we took less. Now, we started off at $5,000.
And what did it work its way up to?
50, I think, at that now.
Wow. Yeah, that's great. Yeah, we're going to put an ad out in Grit. It's a magazine that kids sell to buy model airplanes. Drew, we wear that?
No.
Now, Adam, let's talk about Adam's self-esteem here for a second.
Oh, it's a nefarious story.
Let's all Must help we? Each other.
What? Yeah, I don't know what a handsome genius I am. That's really my problem. Well, here, if you want to know about my self-esteem, here's my theory on self-esteem. I believe that
it's not self-abuse.
Basically, gets carved into you very early in life.
That's true.
By the time you're out of junior high, the cement has dried.
Yeah.
Now, you can buy yourself a Porsche, you can bang yourself a supermodel, but inside, you still feel like the 12-year-old that wasn't paid much attention to, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I also think that your feeling of yourself toward the opposite sex is something that gets carved in early as well, meaning if your guy didn't get much in junior high and didn't get looked at much in high school, no matter what you do in life, I don't care if you get an Academy Award or you're the head of some publishing empire, you still will look at yourself as that sort of guy who didn't do too good with chicks. Conversely, you could be fat, bald, and working at the post office. If you got laid a lot in the ninth grade, you still look at yourself as a bit of a player. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
So I grew up in a very humble environment, and I just look at myself as a guy with a buck tooth and a Brillo head.
And it's... I used to argue with you.
I'm not too... Actually, I do have, I have now a hairy ass I can add to that because I did have that in
thank
the...
Thank God. So it sounded grim until you said that.
Yeah. Now it's a pretty picture.
How exactly is your ball sack?
The ball sack's big. And unfortunately, it dwarfs the penis. Bridget.
Yes.
So, what was the question finally?
Okay. Actually, I had two questions. One's kind of small. Drew, I've heard you talked about it before, and I was had a class in college about it, and I'm not quite sure if it's true or if it's somewhat true. Is there, when you're young and your brain is still developing certain parts, like your emotions and things, and you have been abused, does that not cause brain damage to those certain parts of your brain?
It causes not damage, but alterations.
Okay. That's happened to me, but...
There's a guy by the name of Alan Shore at UCLA who's really working this out very nicely in a theory called the attachment theory, and he describes those alterations as ruptures in the normal developmental process.
The other question is the most important one, and I've been dying to ask this, and I've been thinking that somebody's going to call and have a similar question, but nobody really has. I have been in enough bad relationships, you know, reflective of what has happened to me, and I'm fully aware of why I did it and this and that, and I kind of feel like I wasted a big part of my life on those relationships, but the point that I'm at now is that I'm not seeing anybody. I feel, I feel scarred, I feel damaged, like damaged package that nobody wants, that no decent guy who finds out about me and what's happened to me in my past is going to want to spend the time to be with me, and I'm just in the process right now of just total celibacy. I'm not even seeing anyone. And
but what's the question about that?
The question is, how do I make the transition from this, you know, bad relationship role that I was on to, you know, getting into a more healthy relationship?
So right now you're avoiding the whole thing by not having any relationships.
Yeah, because
that... Oh, hold on a second. Wait a minute. I mistakenly pushed it. What is she on?
Two.
Sorry, because you what, Bridget?
I said I don't know how to get on the right track towards, you know, a healthy relationship. I have had nothing but, you know, bad luck there, so...
Yeah.
Well, it's way more than luck.
Yeah.
I mean, it's nothing to do with luck. It was sort of preordained by your horrible environment you grew up in. There's no magic answer for this. You get into therapy, you feel better about yourself, you get secure, and then you start magically becoming attracted to other people
that are healthy.
You
can also look into survivors, groups, and ways that can help you heal, at least to the point that you can make some good decisions.
I got to add to that, if I may. It's my experience, and I've known several women like this, that when I met them, I was attracted to what I was attracted to. I wasn't attracted to their screwed-upness. I wasn't attracted to their terrible history. I was attracted to their charisma. Sometimes the most screwed-up women have the most charisma because it's almost like an equation where they have such low self-worth that they hold nothing back and put everything out. So they project 100%, which is very charismatic.
Well, they make the best strippers. There's no doubt about that.
That's, by the way, the furthest extension. You're right.
Yeah.
That's true. But I'm talking about people who weren't strippers necessarily, who you meet, and they put out this fantastic energy. And all that is sexual energy, because they're not holding back. They're actually, it's just abandonment. They roll, every roll of the dice is the whole bankroll.
Right.
So it becomes attractive, becomes engaging. You fall for them, you talk to them, you get involved with them, and they start saying, well, you know, I was raped as a child. Well, that's terrible, but I still love you. And then, well, you know, I did this. Well, okay, fine. And I had this one girlfriend who was a brilliant writer, really a brilliant woman. Her name was Karen Dillon, one of the great friends and loves of my life. And she, when they was telling me all this litany of terrible things, I said, Karen, let me stop you right there. There's nothing you can tell me that will change the way I feel about you, because I already love the whole.
Mm-hmm.
So now you can just tell me the parts. But the parts make up the whole. So you can tell me all the bad parts, but I've already seen all the good parts, and cumulatively, the whole is fantastic. I believed in her. She didn't believe in herself. And
right,
the point of Bridget is that, you know, when you want to change that dynamic, you have to simply believe in yourself. You have to believe that the future is fresh, and it's unscarred. The past is what it is, and it's already gone and spent, so let it go. That, you know, somebody's going to meet you who likes you for who you are, doesn't know about the past, doesn't care about the past, likes you for who you are. Be that person. Have confidence in it. Draw confidence from it. Don't anchor yourself down to a tragic past. We can escape our pasts.
Yeah, it's like a beautiful mosaic that was made out of recycled trash or something. You know what I mean?
That makes them feel good.
Well, it's just a bunch of little parts that aren't that good looking on their own.
I think we should have quit after what I said.
but understand that part of the pathology of having been through all that is being unable to accept any genuine positive input from another person because you feel too shameful about yourself.
Okay.
Well, you're right, of course. I mean, what I'm saying is hopeful. I hope people can someone's having sex while we're talking. I love this. This is
Drew, listen, I'm going to kill myself.
All right, go
on here. All right. For Christ's sake. Megan.
Yeah.
You're 13.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Well, my brother is, like, really protective when it comes to, like, guys and stuff. I mean, like, it's, like, beyond help. And, I like his best friend, so I guess it's not helping much.
Yeah.
And, I try to talk to him about it because whenever I'm, like, on the phone with my friends or something, and I'll be talking about, like, his friend, and, my brother just come in and be like, shut up, God, you're such a dork. And, like, I'm like, okay, whatever. And I try to talk to him about it, like, see what his problem with it is, and he like, never wants to talk about it, so I don't know what to do.
How old's your brother?
He's 15.
So he's a couple years older?
Yeah.
How old's his friend?
15.
Hey, Megan?
Yeah.
Can you tell whoever's yamping in the background to shut up?
Oh, shut up, guys.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, we're trying to do a real show here. You know?
Yeah. All right.
We're professionals.
What about, you like this 15-year-old guy as a friend of your brother's?
Yeah, I've, like, known him all my life, and I've liked him for, like, a couple years now.
But your brother would go through the roof if he found out.
Yeah.
Again, your brother's not just protective in regard to this guy. He's protective in general in your life.
Yeah. I mean, I talked to this guy on, like, the phone, like, maybe a couple months ago, and he, like made me hang up with him.
Yeah, but that was that guy. Maybe he knows something about that guy that he can't really tell you, or he has some feeling about the guy that he may not be about wanting to intrude in all areas of your life. He may be trying to protect you from this guy.
From his friend or
From his friend. He can still be his friend and not want his sister to...
Well, who's the other guy?
Yeah, I'm lost. Missed that, too.
What other guy?
Oh, it was just this guy that, like, I met through another friend.
Okay, so here's what Drew's asking. Is it all men, or do you think he knows something about this one guy who he's friends with?
I think it's all men.
Okay, so he's being overprotective.
Yeah.
And that is backfiring.
Uh-huh.
That's what, it's diabolical. I wish I could have gotten my sister to do this. She could have told a few of her friends, I forbid you from dating Adam, and they probably would have done it just to screw with her. But instead, she said, have at it, and they went, no.
The best endorsement I've ever had, ever, is when one woman has said to another woman, don't go out with Bob. That's brilliant.
Right.
I mean, I try to get that kind of endorsement.
Game. Oh, yeah. I love that. It's like the do not touch by the statue at the museum.
Whatever you do, don't go out with that guy.
Right.
And you just wait for the call.
Right.
Because it's done.
But I think Megan's brother's helping her. And although Megan doesn't experience
it that
way.
I'm with Megan's brother. You know, I was that way with my sister. And I told my sister, I used to beat my sister's boyfriends up, man. She was young and her boyfriend was young. I was a few years older. But I used to, like, I was very Italian, very protective. So I said to her one day, you'll thank me for this. And one day, 10 years later, we were sitting in Fort Lauderdale with my grandmother, and my sister Nina said, you know, said, I'm going to do this in front of somebody. I'm going to thank you because you kept me going.
See,
you kept me right.
One thing the 15-year-old
She's
brother...
She's a lesbian now, but at least she thanked Bob.
From going to the other side. One thing the 15-year-old male brother knows is how 15-year-old males think.
Yeah.
Oh,
that's
yes.
what the 13-year-old girl doesn't know. And that's what he's
protecting. Don't you think at 13 you're a little bit young to have sex?
Well, let me get her
She didn't say that. She didn't say that's what she wants
Megan,
to
Megan, do you want to have sex with a guy?
No.
Okay, just want a date.
Yeah.
You know, listen, when you're 15...
I withdraw my last question.
you'll thank your brother someday.
Yes.
Yes, that's the point.
Listen, here's what you should do. Instead of hanging out with one of his contemporaries, I mean, that 2 years is a pretty big year.
Huge.
A couple big years. When you're one of you's in the 7th grade, the other's in the 10th grade, or whatever the hell it is, why don't you just go out with other 7th graders, and he won't know them, and he probably won't get involved. And that solves the problem. But don't dip into his corral to get these guys.
He knows what's going on in their heads. That's the scary part.
Oh, yeah. And they talk about it. And the last thing a guy... Listen, guys always talk about their sexual conquests, especially when they're 15, 16 years old. And the last thing a guy wants is to have that locker room talk and have his sister be the recipient.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. Hallie.
Yeah.
You're 19.
Mm-hmm.
You're on with Bob Guccione Jr.
Hi.
Hi.
Well, there's this problem, right? My sister, I just call her my sister because she's, like, my best friend. She's going out with this guy that
I like, but, you know, I have a boyfriend already. And I know that her boyfriend kind of likes me, too, because he's told me before, you know. And, you know, I don't really know if I should, like, dump my boyfriend and go out with him because, you know, I don't want to, like, stop being friends with my friend. But, you know, I really like him.
Don't do it. More chaos.
He's not worth it if he's going to do that to your friend. He's going to do the same thing to you with somebody else.
But, you know...
Why do you like these kinds of guys?
I don't know.
Yeah, sometimes...
So why do you,
you know,
sound nine?
Huh?
You're 19. Why do you sound nine?
What do you mean I sound nine?
Well, what happened? Something happened, right?
How old are you really?
19.
19.
She's 19. It's just something happened a while ago. Somebody... Some death in the family or somebody walk out or something?
No.
Huh?
Did you already have an affair with this guy?
No, I haven't. But, you know, I know that he, like, likes me because, you know, he does, he, like, shows it a lot. And, well, he's going out with my best friend, and I don't know if I should, like, dump my boyfriend.
Hallie, we got the picture. We've told you no.
Yeah.
We're just trying to figure out why you would choose to do something like this.
Well, she can do it just because she's 19 and a girl, and, yeah. You know, people are allowed to make mistakes. But I'm picking up her young voice. Was there some sort of trauma to you when you were younger?
6 to 9, something happened to you?
Well...
What happened?
Not that I remember.
Okay, first, no. Now... Let's ask the question again. You ask it this time.
All right. What happened? Anything? Where's your dad?
My dad is asleep.
Your dad's asleep. When did you lose your virginity?
I haven't.
You're virgin?
Uh-huh.
Has anyone ever touched you in any way that was older?
No.
No. Why don't we believe you? I mean, why do you sound...
Hesitant.
So hesitant about that?
I don't know.
Well, all right, let me backtrack a little bit. You're a virgin now.
Uh-huh.
You have any older brothers?
Yeah.
Stepbrothers?
Huh? No.
No stepbrothers, just older brothers.
Uh-huh.
Any of their friends ever do anything to you when you were younger?
No.
No?
Uh-uh.
Anyone know, was your dad physical with you? Did he ever hit you?
No.
No.
Uh-uh.
So nothing ever, no trauma, no alcoholism, no nothing.
Mm-mm.
You sound disappointed.
Hold on, I am.
Adam, you're stretching.
Well, no, there's something, watch, I'll show you.
Did you, like, support a team and they lost?
True, ask me some questions and I'll tell you how
the
answers go. I think,
guys, the trail is cold.
Listen, is any alcoholism in your family?
No.
Any abuse when you were age 6 to 9?
No.
Now play Hallie. Any abuse when you were 6 to 9?
See, 6 to 9, 6 to 9, 6 to 9. No.
Any alcoholism in the family?
No. Hallie, Drew and I, because we do the show all the time, are picking up on something in your voice that sounds very young.
Like what?
Like you sounding very young. And whenever we pick that up, there's usually something that happened when you were younger that is affecting you as a 19-year-old.
Causing an arrest of your development.
And we're trying to figure out what that was. Could you be honest with us?
Let me think back.
All right, we'll go to break while she thinks about it.
All right. Hallie?
Yeah?
I'm going to go get some peanuts from the vending machine, all right?
Okay.
Think back. You know what we're talking about?
Yeah, I do.
Okay. Be honest with us, and we'll talk to you when we come back, okay?
Okay.
All right. We'll get to that. Bob Guccione is here. Pardon me, Junior is here. And Drew, Senior? What's your dad's name?
Dad.
Morton.
Morton.
I got to tell you, guys are good. You picked up something there that I would not have got.
Well, we don't know. We don't know that it's there yet, but...
It should be.
It should be when we come back.
Picked up a trail.
Call 1-800-LOVE-191 to broadcast your problems to the public.
Loveline will be right back.
KFMA.
Love problems.
Hello, this is Richard Branson, and you're listening to Loveline with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
Yes, you is. Well, there's a mogul, Richard Branson. I think some guy circumnavigated the globe in a balloon before Branson did.
Yeah, I bet he didn't like that. Yeah.
I heard Branson's going to pay him to go back.
Pay him to recant.
Oh, that's got to suck. Bob Guccione Jr. is here. Gear is the name of his latest effort.
Shall you read it?
I will. Okay. I don't read much. I don't read much of anything.
Why did you hire someone to read to you?
You know, I got to tell you, I am such a poor reader that when I do a lot of writing, I have to do a lot of writing for other jobs that I have, and it's kind of bizarre because I don't spell and I don't read very well. And the way I can hear things clearly is I tell people to read it out loud, and then I listen to it.
I'm aware of that, Adam.
Yeah, don't I always tell you to do that, Drew?
Always.
Right. Like, if I read something, I won't know how it sounds or if it's funny or what it is, but if I have somebody read it and present it to me, then I can tell.
Yeah, when I edit my own copy, I have two friends of mine who are great writers who edit me, and I read it to them.
Yeah,
and it's always much better because when you read it, it has an authenticity or it doesn't.
I couldn't, especially, yeah. I mean, this is meant to be read, but there's a lot of copy, whether it's commercials or doing a voiceover or something, where it's meant to be heard.
Mm-hmm.
And the guys who write it, I always yell at people about this. I go, get the guys who write this to read it aloud. Absolutely. Because it looks great on paper because it's full of alliteration and things mm-hmm. rhyme and all that. But when you say it, it sounds like you have marbles in your mouth and you're muddling through it. And I always say to them, have the guys read it aloud, because then you would hear immediately it doesn't sound right. And that, and if it's a radio commercial, then that's what it needs.
And if it sounds right, even if it's a text for an article in a magazine, if it sounds right, it'll read right.
Right.
I mean, we're getting esoteric now.
Okay.
The Let's point get back is to sex.
Pay somebody to read aloud.
Exactly.
Hallie?
Yeah.
So Hallie's 19. She has a boyfriend. She's interested in her best friend. I mean, her friend's so close, she calls her a sister. She's interested in her man.
Why? Why are you interested in her man?
I don't know, because, I know he is interested in me, too.
But there's got to be a lot of other men who've been interested in you, and there's a lot of other men in the world.
And you have a boyfriend.
And you have a boyfriend, and you're going to be screwing up a lot of different lives, including his, by the way.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, well, he'll be sure to reciprocate.
And you called her your sister. I mean, you guys, does that mean anything to you?
It also means to me that she's sort of looking for a life preserver out there in a hostile world. See, I got to have somebody I can cling to.
I think it's more chaos.
Hallie, what's up? Did you do any soul searching during the break?
Yeah, I remembered now that, well, me and my friend, my sister, that's what I call her. When we were like probably 7th or 8th grade, we would like just go out to movies and stuff, and we would scam with guys that were like 4 or 5 years older than us.
So we would pretend
that we were older.
So when you were 7th or 8th grade, meaning like 13 or 14.
12 or 11.
Mm-hmm.
12. Well, it's 13 or something. You would hook up with guys that were like 18?
Yeah.
Okay.
What would you do with them?
Scam.
Is that like make out? That's a new age for hand job.
Yeah.
No, what would you do with them?
New age.
Well, it was in the movies, really nothing that big, but
Mm-hmm. We're kind of looking for something before that. What about before that? Anything? Dad, how's dad?
Hmm?
How's your dad?
He's fine.
Yeah. You love him?
Yeah.
He takes care of you?
What?
He takes care of you?
No.
Why not?
He's 50. What's my dad doing in Israel?
Yeah, we're not going to get anywhere with that.
Okay. All right, was he a good father? Did he take care of you?
Yeah.
And mom? Everything okay with her?
Yeah.
Okay. You never had an eating disorder or anything like that, Hallie?
No, not really, because... Well, they were really good parents,
Did you ever have an eating disorder or anything like that?
Well, I fought with them a lot, but that I didn't...
We're on to food now, Hallie. Did you ever have an eating disorder?
No, but I tried to.
You tried to have an eating disorder?
Yeah, because I was fat.
And what do you mean you tried to have it? Boy, Hallie is just...
I tried to be anorexic.
And what does that mean, tried to?
I couldn't. I was like a chillier, and so... I wanted to be skinny like all the rest of them, but, I was fat.
Did you vomit or use laxatives or anything like that?
No.
Okay.
All right, Hallie?
Uh-huh.
Don't do this and start reading more. I rarely rarely tell our listeners to do that. But Hallie, you're 19, and it's like, you know what? I feel like a 911 operator when a 6-year-old father has a heart attack and they call up and they're going, "Is he in the house?"
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like you're watching Sesame Street and crying at the same time.
Yeah.
It's hard to talk to you, Hallie. You don't sound 19. Are you sure you're 19?
Yes, I am.
Okay. All right. Well, there's something going on with you that's sort of more than what you're willing to tell us, I think. And we can't get to that tonight, so we're going to let you go.
All right?
Okay.
Don't do what you're planning.
Yeah, I agree. Don't
It'd be a disaster for everyone, including yourself.
Yeah. Boy, there was something going on there.
Yeah, I can't. We'll never get to it.
Liz.
Yeah.
You're 18.
Hi.
What's happening? Now, look at Liz. She's a year younger than Hallie.
Yeah, and she's with us.
Right. Yeah.
Liz, what's the question?
Okay. I am pregnant. I want to say really quickly that for people who are having sex, not to count on the morning after pill to save them.
Uh-oh, what happened?
Well, I was in a sexual relationship, and one night we just were really dumb and didn't use any protection at all. And after it happened, talked about it and decided that we would get the pill, and we did, and it didn't work.
How long after the contact did you use the pill?
The next day.
6 months.
24 hours? 12 hours?
Really?
24 hours?
Yeah, about 24 hours.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Oh,
that's
bad. How did that fail? Really?
Well, it's only 70%.
Oh, 70?
Yeah. Yeah. It's 70-75% effective. So, you know, with almost a third of people, it's not going to work for. So there you go.
Yeah. So it was, and I took it, and I thought it was fine, but then I was really worried, so I took a test a couple weeks after and found out that I was.
Wow. So how far along are you?
I'm about 6 weeks.
Okay.
Yeah. And I am scheduled for an abortion in 2 weeks.
Okay.
And I'm really nervous because I just am. And I was just, the thing is, I can't tell my parents.
Yeah.
And I can't really miss a lot of school because I'm about to graduate and I need to be there.
Well, you'll be back in school very quickly.
I mean, that's what I figured, but
they actually have tutors in the clinic now, I heard.
That won't be the issue. The issue is more the emotional and hormonal consequences, and the change in the hormonal environment does really affect them. My experience has been that women are not sufficiently prepared for this.
Yeah.
How much of a sense of loss there is, seems to me a biologically induced sense, as well as all the ambivalence of having given up a child.
So your body goes from pregnant with a whole bunch of hormones raging through it to unpregnant.
And it's a very painful process.
Yeah, I'm worried about the emotional, but, I'm trying to, work through that. It's
good.
Been hard, but I'm just more worried about the next day.
Yeah.
I know I'm not, expecting to be able to go to school, but I'm kind of worried that I might have to. And I don't know,
Can't you schedule it on a Friday?
Huh?
Can't you schedule this on a Friday?
No, because the Planned Parenthood clinic that I'm doing it through only does them on Tuesdays.
Oh, boy.
So I have to miss the Tuesday. And then I'm going to stay at a friend's house, but I don't know about the next day.
Yeah, but how big a deal is it, you missing a day of school?
Right.
Well,
When I was in high school, I'd have abortions just to miss school. I actually had that on a note.
Well,
they were too scared to ask.
If you miss more than 10 days of school or of a certain period of class, they'll fail you in the class.
You're not going to miss 10 days.
But I've already missed a couple, because I'm a spring semester senior and I'm really not. Sometimes I'm in the mood to go.
Well, why don't you just go do it on a Friday and not do it through Planned Parenthood and just do it another way?
I guess I could. I just really want to get it done, and since I'm getting closer.
Tuesday to Friday is not such a big difference.
Yeah.
Drew, when you're having an abortion and you're at the 2-month period and you're 18 years old, are you going to be okay to get back in school 2 days later?
2 days later.
I'm sure. Yeah, I mean.
All right. So listen, Liz.
Yes.
I know you're at a point in your life where you're worrying about everything.
Mm-hmm.
But you get the procedure done on a Tuesday, and then you'll miss Wednesday, and you'll be back on Thursday.
Okay.
And that's it.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll do it on a Friday.
Well,
yeah.
Yeah. Why ruin your weekend?
Yeah. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
All right, don't freak out.
I'm trying not to.
There's many a woman has done this procedure and gone on and had a fruitful life, okay?
Okay.
Okay, baby.
Thank you.
Take care of yourself.
I will.
All right.
All right.
All right. Listen, everybody, this is what happens. forget about this AIDS. Wear the condom so you don't knock people up. This is what's destroying this country of ours. Oh, this venereal disease and AIDS and all that, it's nothing. It's nothing. It's all these screwed up kids. This is what's dismantling this country. I don't understand why we won't address this as a country. Steve.
Yeah.
You're 20.
Yes, sir.
And you're referring to what our last caller's child would be were she to have had him.
Well, she even sounded decent. I mean, it's sort of catch-22, but she's smart enough not to want to screw her life up with a child. She wants to go to college. So I don't even worry if somehow magically she had her child. It's the ones that are 17 and want something to cuddle.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a big empty hole in them.
The ones who are 43 and want something to cuddle. Mm. I'm serious. That to me is really...
It's weird. It's weird, but they can afford it, so I don't care. Well, that's my whole feeling. If you can pay for your kid's therapy, fine.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I mean, they can afford it, but I don't know if it's right. I knew a woman who actually got pregnant by me. I was like a Rolodex date. I was good DNA. She got pregnant by me. She tricked me. And I said, when I realized what was happening, I said, well, okay, it's not a way I would have planned it, but we'll do it. Says, you know, you and I will be good parents. We're not going to be together. She actually lost the child. I was prepared to go through with it, but she lost the child. But I said, she said, well, can we try again? I said, well, we didn't try in the first place. And I'm not here to, like, be a sperm donor for you to have a pet.
Wow.
That's what it came down to.
How'd she trick you into having sex with her, Bob?
Well, she did, that part wasn't so hard.
Wow. Yeah, but a I'd lot have of
like,
cunning.
Like she came over.
Showed Bob a picture of a couple of animals humping, and he got excited and jumped on her leg.
Why am I laughing at myself?
All right.
This is late.
But she said she was on the pill or something, right?
Well, I had dated her earlier in the year for a few months, and she had been on the pill, and she said she was again, and she wasn't. It was a deliberate thing to get pregnant.
Right.
But, you know, the idea that, and she said to me, well, don't worry, no one need to know you're the father. I said, well, how would you do that to your own child? So torment them that they spend their whole life wondering who their father is. Is this not a pet?
Well, that's our point, which is if you're going to have kids, don't do it to fill some void.
Exactly.
Don't do it to right some wrong of the past. Do it because you're ready to be parents. You have a strong relationship and you want to bring a child into the world. Not as a crutch for you. It's not an extension
exactly
of you.
Right.
Steve.
Yes.
You're 20. What's going on?
I don't know much. How's it going?
Good.
Good, good. Well, lately I've been having a hard time finding someone who I can start a relationship with.
Yeah.
And
why is that?
Well, see, before I broke up with my last girlfriend, I went for about 3 or 4 years where I consistently had someone.
What is your question for us?
Is it some kind of psychological thing? Because what's happening is I'm finding girls that I'm interested in, and they're not interested in me. And then whenever I find someone who's interested in me, I'm not interested in them.
What are you doing?
You're 20, right?
Yeah.
I'm 43. I have the same problem.
What are you doing with your life?
There is no hope.
what are you doing with your life?
I'm working a lot and going to school full time.
Right. It'll solve itself.
Yeah. You know what? It's funny. I said that a bit flippantly, but actually as you get older, you do get a little more sense of yourself. And you don't look at it in those terms. The reality is you will meet some people who you're attracted to who are not as attracted to you. They will be attracted to you. You're not attracted to them. That's not going to change. But it's not a reflection of your worth. And as you get a little more a grip on the sense that not every action in life and every transaction changes your worth like a stock going up and down on the market, you get to feel better and the rhythms of life become easier to deal with. And certainly, you know, at 20, do not throw the towel in. I mean, I ain't throwing it in at 43, so don't throw it in at 20.
Yeah, I was saying to a friend of mine, we were at the YMCA in Burbank a while back, and I noticed a lot of guys in their 70s nude shooting pool. And I was saying to my buddy, you know,
I love this story.
guys at the Y, it's true, and in Burbank especially, they have this, it's a horrible planning, by the way. They have the rec area right off the men's shower. And guys, when they're in their 70s, no matter how decrepit they look and how horrible they look, they'll walk around nude. And I said to them, these guys look horrible. I mean, some of these guys, you know, they've no penis and a huge scrotum, and they got like a boil on their ass. And they're shooting pool in the nude. They're just walking around naked having conversations. And I said to him, why are they doing this? And he said, they don't care.
Yeah.
Yeah. They don't care. They're 75 years old, and you can kiss their ass.
Yeah.
They just don't care.
Right.
And, you know, remember when you were 19 and you did a few push-ups before you even went out to the pool?
Yeah.
Just try to get a little blood in your pecs?
Exactly.
These guys are 75. They look like a sack filled with sand and horseshoes.
And pus.
And they just walk around. The penis is actually up inside of them, and the scrotum, they're moving the scrotum with a wheelbarrow. And they could give a rat's ass. They could care
they
less.
They know happiness. They
right.
know bliss.
That's right. It's too bad you can't have that sort of security.
With the body of a 19-year-old,
with
yeah.
the body of a 19-year-old, but it
when
just...
When you should be able to use it, yeah.
God is cruel that way. All right, Bob Guccione Jr. is here. We'll take a break, and we'll be back.
Love Line with Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla. We'll be right back.
KFMA.
It is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191.
We have fun, though, looking at how smokers are dealt with in airports.
Kid Rock will
get locked into rooms.
Be in here tomorrow night. Let me finish my riff here, Drew. Did I give the phone number? Bob Guccione Jr. is here. Gear is the name of his latest magazine, and it's real good looking. So I suggest all you folks go out and get it. And it's one of those things that makes you look cool when it's sitting around. I believe that's a half of a magazine's use.
Is that three quarters?
Yeah. It's got to look good hanging around the office. Got to look good on the coffee table. This has got the Daryl Hannah and Bucks humping. So, oh, and guys in riot gear. It's really...
It's a cool piece, actually. We wanted to do a piece on the five best military elite units in the world.
Wow.
As a quick piece.
What are they?
Well, the SAS of Britain is one, and the Israeli anti-terrorism squad is number one.
Mm-hmm.
The Israelis basically have that down pat, you know?
Well, they get a lot of practice.
Get an Israeli on your side.
Really?
No, they're the best. They're the best. Delta Force, the U.S. Army, comes in a whopping fourth.
How
behind,
do they?
I don't know how
LAPD
we did
SWAT
this,
team
we rated
comes
the
in.
French SWAT team ahead of them.
Oh,
the Francis Group de Dump de Vengeance.
Those Delta guys got to kill themselves.
Bore their victims.
But how do you rate them?
LAPD SWAT is fifth. Now the LAPD SWAT, it should be said, is fifth because they shoot their own.
Oh, really?
They shoot their own citizens.
Yeah.
But they have a high kill rate. No, I'm joking. I mean, they're a very good SWAT team. We have a guy who we've made our spy editor, Sam Katz, wrote this piece. And his whole beat, his whole life has been, you know, military units and spies. He's doing a piece in our next issue, which was calling the sex issue, on famous female spies who have seduced some of the world's worst, you know, most corrupt diplomats and politicians and tyrants and got them to leave their safe places and then... They've been picked up by the...
Oh, really?
Yeah, by the law enforcement that were after them. Very interesting story.
Yeah, it's great, because no matter how powerful a guy gets, you wave a little of that in front of him. And
it is unbelievable.
Oh, it's great. You could get, like, Noriega to run down to the 7-Eleven and get you a pack of cigarettes if you had a really tight ass.
Yeah,
you know, you could have half the country looking for him.
Nothing has changed since, and I'm going to join Drew with Greek mythological metaphors here, but nothing has changed since Helen of Troy.
No.
You know?
All right, Drew?
Yep.
You ready to move forward here? Lee?
Yes.
You're 16.
Yes, I am.
What's going on?
I have a question whether or not you can get herpes virus transferred onto your hand.
Well, transferred by your hand, or can you get... Can you get an infection on your hand?
Yeah.
You actually can, and it's called herpetic whitlow in that case.
Could you get rid of it?
It's no different than any other herpes. It will be with you.
It's not very common, though, is it, Drew?
It's not very common. It's difficult to diagnose because it can be just sort of a recurrent swelling or sore, and it's very painful. The whole arm can swell up. It's a big mess. Sometimes.
It's like a bump, like a little one, like a couple of them.
Yeah.
What, did you, give a hobo a hand job or something? What are you worried about?
Actually, I know he's, like, been around. Oh, I found this out later, that he, like, had a lot of unprotected sex.
Mm-hmm.
Prior to me messing around with him, and...
Did you put your hand on him?
Yeah.
It could be just some sort of skin infection, incidentally, you caught, but it's something that somebody ought to look at.
I don't even think she has anything. I think this is all hypothetical.
Oh.
No, I think... I'm pretty... I don't know. It's spread. It's like...
Does your boyfriend have something?
I don't know. See, he told me he's got checked out. Well,
she
I
has something.
Ask him now because he's in jail. But
Reliable source.
Mm-hmm. Huh?
Lee, this has to be looked at. One thing I've learned during this show is that skin lesions are very difficult for people to describe. It's suspicious what you're describing. They have something that's painful, clustered bumps, vesicles, that sort of thing, blisters. But it can also be just a regular old staph or a strep skin infection. So get it checked out, okay?
What's he in the clink for?
He told me he's not allowed to tell me.
Oh, okay.
But
that's probably some white collar crime.
But the bumps are like they spread like onto my other hand. I don't know if it's kind of from
that would
more
not,
on my right hand.
Yeah, that would not be typical of herpes, but it's got to be looked at, Lee. Period. All right?
Uh-huh.
Okay. Yeah. Don't
it's probably not herpes and you'll feel better learning that.
Yeah. Does she have to tell the doctor she was diddling a felon,
no,
or can she just say she has these things?
I want her to look at this rash.
Diddling a felon.
Oh, this poor Lee, start making your choices more carefully.
Oh.
You can only imagine this guy. I love chicks too. Chicks will marry you in prison. Mm. Guys would never do that.
No.
Guys don't want to marry you when you're on the outside. Forget about prison. I was just talking about this the other day. I was outraged because I was watching this thing on Theodore Bundy. And, you know, he used to like to rape and kill all these young college age and high school chicks. And when he was on the inside, he was waiting for the electric chair. He had like, I don't know, 15 years of appeals or something. He got married and sired a kid.
How did he sire the kid?
He gets a conjugal visit. He gets married.
Jesus.
You know,
talk about bad seed. I hate to be so prejudicial, but...
Yeah, absolutely, and
I would think it would take away the conjugal rights of somebody who is that bad.
Yes, that's what we say.
You know? I don't want you getting married in prison. Well, you know, this Richard Ramirez, who is he, the Hillside Strangler, the slasher, whoever this guy is, this guy's married.
Yeah. It's a bit of a conflict, isn't it? I mean, here we are, the state is putting the man to death while allowing him to procreate and... it's a bizarre one.
Yeah, let me explain.
It's not the DNA I think we really should be encouraging.
As far as rights go, once you've decided that you're going to put somebody to death because of a huge charge of electricity, his other rights are a distant second to that. You cannot say we're going to kill the guy and we have to look out for his personal rights.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Because it just doesn't make sense. So if you're going to deny him his right to live, I think you can just take it the next step and deny him his right to marry.
At least deny him Viagra.
Yeah. Oh, my God. It is. It kills me. And these guys get married in prison all day long, and there's always a bunch of screwed-up broads who want to marry him. I mean, I think the Melendez kids are both married.
Is that right?
Did I say their name right?
Menendez.
That's right. Those guys
are
married.
Here's a quickie. Ryan.
Yes.
What's going on?
Not much. I've been with my girlfriend for 12 months now, and we started having sex like 5 months ago, and I've always pulled out and everything, and tonight, like 2 hours ago, I just didn't for some reason. It sounds stupid, but I don't know what happened, but I just didn't.
Well, it sounds frankly more stupid to be using the pull-out method in the
Yeah, I understand, and we've been meaning to get her pills and everything. It was just not,
How about just walking over to a drugstore and getting some condoms?
Yeah, I don't know, but I know I'm stupid about that and everything. I'm just wondering what to do.
Get the morning after pill immediately.
Yeah, I was planning on doing that, but more importantly, what should I tell her? Should I tell her that I didn't, or just give her this pill and be like...
No, crush it up and put it in her cereal.
First of all, I'm sure she knows, and you should be discussing this with her.
Yeah.
Believe me, she already knows.
And listen, how delicate are her sensibilities? You've been whacking off on her belly for the last year. You think she's going to be upset about this? I mean, like, she's sipping tea in the parlor, and she's going to be put off. I mean, come on, Ryan. She's stupid too, right?
Yeah.
Okay, then.
I think she'll be, like, really, really mad at me, like, because it's an irresponsible thing to do.
Already knows.
Listen.
Yeah, she knows. Believe me, nobody knows. She knows.
And it's no less irresponsible.
But she didn't know.
Listen, it's no more irresponsible than using the pull-out method in the first place. So give me a break.
All right.
Every time you use that pull-out method, you should be using the morning after pill.
Okay.
So just get with it, all right?
All right.
All right.
Thank you.
Ryan, don't screw around. I don't want to take care of your kids.
All right, thank you.
All right, take care.
Screwball. Worried about his girlfriend going to be pissed off. And let me tell you what's wrong with the pullout.
I hope she knows.
But let me tell you
Of course she knows. I mean, you know.
The thing that's inherently flawed about the pullout method is guys can do a lot of things at once. I mean, they can shave, drive a car, and talk on a cell phone. But when they're having the orgasm, it's one of the few times they have difficulty doing other things. And it feels like there's 1,000 hands holding your ass in place when you're coming. And it's like you cannot go past that. It's a horrible, horrible method, this pull-out method. That's why I always finish with oral sex. That is my method, even if I do it on myself. Bob Guccione Jr. is here. We'll take a quick break. We'll be back. Huh? All right. That's it. Bob, thank you very much for coming in. We're plumb out of show. Everyone go out and get gear. Can you subscribe to it?
Absolutely.
Do that. It'll look cool. And it's fun when you subscribe to the magazine.
You feel good about yourself.
You will?
Yeah, absolutely. You also become infinitely more sexually attractive.
Oh, really? Yeah, and you smell better, too. Yeah, because I have those little samplers
picked up
in there.
With the spirit of this. I can't even go on.
Drew?
Yeah.
You done?
I was up all night with my daughter vomiting last night.
You were vomiting or
my
she
daughter,
was?
She was vomiting.
Okay.
So I'm basically done.
All right. Kid Rock will be in here tomorrow night. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
More jello, Mom.
Mommy!
This has been Loveline. The views expressed on Loveline are not necessarily those of the staff, the management, or the sponsors of this radio station.
And are probably not the views of Westwood One Entertainment.
Loveline is produced by Ann Wilkins Engel.
Now, please listen to this station longer.